I have the pleasure to introduce José Antonio de la Peña. He has been one of our brightest students and researchers. He has got a lot of prizes. I will not say you which ones. There are too many. But the most important is that he is member of the Colegio Nacional. And besides of his contribution to mathematics, he has a very important contribution to the politics of science. He was he held several important roles, positions in the CONACYT. He was one of the chiefs there, and during his period, it was a lot of good things, not only for mathematics, but for the science in general. So now, José Antonio will speak about the generations of algebras and models.
Thank you. Thank you, Raimundo, for the presentation. I would like to thank the organizing committee and Pepe in particular for the invitation. It's really an honor to be here this afternoon. So it looks perhaps a little bit specialized, the title of the generations. But this is rather elementary. Most things I would say. Okay, although it was introduced by Christoph, so I keep his notation. So very quickly, the algebras that we consider are associative five-dimensional algebras over a field. And I assume that the field is algebraically closed. The modules over such algebras, this category is given by mod A, and these are the finite modules over the algebra, left modules. This is very general in the following sense. Since the field is algebraically closed, every algebra, every finite-dimensional algebra over the field, is more equivalent to one of those algebras of algebras given by a quiver, a quotient of a quiver algebra by some ideal. Okay. We have an homology theory. Then, in particular, the extensions of simples with I have n. If I take the class of the vertices, this can be associated with the simples. So, we have one simple for every one of the vertices. And the extensions between the simples in I and the simple in J is the number of arrows in this quiver from I to J. So the representations over such algebras are very simple. If you want, they are just functors from the algebra, if you consider the algebra as a category in the usual easy way, from the category to the vector spaces. This means for every arrow, for every vertex here, there's a vector space, and for every arrow, an homomorphism between the corresponding vector spaces. Then I will denote by dimension of the module, the dimension in each of the vector spaces associated to the vertices. I have a duality, which is just a usual duality by the field. Okay. So, what I will do in this talk is to consider the algebras, but I will look at the algebras as elements of a certain space. Here, these are the algebras of dimension n. And I will use some algebra geometry, very little, very simple algebra geometry. Bilinear forms, the bilinear maps, have given a structure to this set with in the field to the power n to the cube. The associative bilinear maps is a closed subset of the bilinear maps in the Sarisky topology. And the associative algebras with one is a affine variety. I will look more carefully at this affine variety. And I could use some little properties of geometric properties of this variety to get the type of results that we have gotten. Group actions. So I will consider the general linear group of dimension n of the space n acts on the usual way, and this action defines the orbits for the isomorphic classes of algebras. So the orbits of an algebra A is just the algebra closed by the action of this linear group. The stabilizer of the action of this group in the algebra is just the automorphism group. And the dimension of the orbit is just the dimension of the group minus the dimension of the automorphisms over A. All this is very simple. So I arrive to the definition of the generation. So I take a variety and a morphism from the variety to the algebras. So this is a family then indicated by this variety. And we say that V is a degeneration of A if there's an open set in set where all the algebras in this family happen to be isomorphic to A. Therefore, B is something like a limit of algebras isomorphic to A. So, B is in the closure, therefore, in the closure of the orbit. An interior fact is that each degeneration can be obtained along a fine line. So, then there exists, this is the complex or the field itself. And then along this line, the image of this line, we can find this, we can realize this degeneration. Well, many results are like this, that you will not find it anywhere. This is folklore, somehow. And not only this result, but many, many others are some type of folklore. So everybody uses them, is known, is not written, etc. Well, this is not folklore. then if you have a morphism between the farm varieties, then the function looking at the image and then the pre-image of points, which and you take the dimension of these fibers, which means the maximum of the dimension of the reducible components of this is upper semi-continuous. Meaning, and this will be important, I will use several times, that if you look at the dimension of the function, and you look at the set, which is open, points having dimension is smaller than a certain number, of any number, this is open for all n. Okay, so few consequences up to now. The function, the algebra associates the dimension of the center, is upper semi-continuous. In particular, the commutative algebras form a closed set in the set of all algebras. The function which associates to each other the automorphism group is upper semi-continuous also. In particular, the set of algebras such that the orbit has dimension is more equal to certain number is closed for every number. Or the dimension of the orbit is equal to the number is the intersection of a closed with an open subset, which is is definition of locally closed for every S. Cauchy cohomology. We will apply these notions to the Cauchy complex of A, which say exactly what it is, because complicated to say, right? So, and you take the homomorphism over the field from B tensor E times with itself to B, and then you evaluate the E plus one tensor just by looking at these alternating sums of the tensors. You form smaller tensors in this way, okay? And then you get a complex, like, which sends the vector space to the dimensions of the vector space to itself, and so on, in such a way that the homology of this complex, which means the kernel divided by the image, is the Eve-Cauchy cohomology of A. Since this is the, usually this is denoted by H, 2H. But since this is the only cohomology I will use, therefore I can just give this notation just with a single H. So, consequences is the dimension, the dimension of the homologies. I will look for every algebra, I will denote the algebras when I look at this set as a variety. I will denote the algebras by Greek letters. And I look at the dimension then of the the ETH Cauchy Cohomology Group. Yep. And then, since this is the dimension, this is the dimension of the kernel minus the dimension of the image, just of the complex. Then it's rather simple to see that this is upper semi-continuous used by the arguments. In particular, it happens that if the n cohomology of A is zero, then the B is a generation of A, then the n cohomology of B is zero. Well, this follows by upper semi-continuous. Then the notion of tangent space. Well, this is rather well known. Suppose that we have a closed set defined by certain polynomials. Then we define the differentials, the derivatives of the functions defined in this set just in this way. Are linear functions. In the tangent space, at a certain vertex, is a linear variety defined by these equations. Okay, this is the usual and very simple form. Well, okay. Now, assume that the first Cauchy cohomology of A happens to be zero, then the following holds. The tangent space to the automorphism of A, the automorphism of A is a linear space. You take the tangent space in the identity, this containing the kernel, and the image is easy to see that it goes to the tangent space. Here is in the orbit of alpha. When I put a zero in the here, this means that this is the orbit. And this is our isomorphism due to the fact that H1 is zero. Then there is a canonical inclusion, then we can take the tangent space. We take an algebra, we take the variety of algebras, take the tangent space at alpha, and the tangent space at the orbit. This is a subspace of this space. We divide these spaces, and this happens to be this is an inclusion. This is not always an isomorphism, but if you take schemes, I will not take schemes, but if you take schemes, it's an isomorphism. In case the third Cauchy cohomology is zero, then it is an isomorphism. And then in this case, if H3, the third Cauchy cohomology of A is zero, then the variety is smooth at the algebra. So this has to do with the rigidity conditions. So I will not go. Okay. So I will say that A is a one-point extension of B by a module M. If I can write A as a triangular ring in B in this side, and then I complete the matrices by this projective space, where M is the radical of this new projective, and K in this vertex. And if you look at the usual matrix operation, this gives the structure of an algebra 2A. And this is so-called one-point extension of A by B. This rather simple construction was introduced by Ringel, probably, isn't it? Because Ringel in his book of 84. Okay. Assume that A is a one-point extension. Then one has the following construction rule for the cohomology groups. So, H0 is included in H of A, is included in H0 of B, and this sends the number of these rings of M divided by K. K, in this case, is just in the center of the number of these K lies. This goes to H1, H1 to of A to B, and this to the extensions. So, well, is rather simple to define. So if you pass an exercise, you put yourselves to define this complex, this the first idea that you have works. But in fact the longest sequence is exact. This was defined by Happel, or this was proved by Happel. And this allows inductive calculation of the Cauchy cohomology of A. If you know the Cauchy cohomology of B, and also then the following is interesting. If M is exceptional, this means only that it has no self-extensions. If the x1 of N with M is zero, then we see that the Cauchy cohomologies are preserved. And therefore, in fact, not only the groups, but the full structure of the rings, the cohomology rings are isomorphic. Okay. This also serves to see some homological properties of the algebras, which I will refer later. Okay, so probably the main definition in this talk is the following: Thame and Wilde, which is it comes from the 70s or 80s. Donovan and Freisler's conjecture in the middle of the 70s. Every algebra is either tame or wild, and I will define this concept here. In fact, there are several stories concerning this conjecture, going back to the middle of the 70s, probably, that then, Peter Gabriel, didn't believe on this conjecture. And in this moment, he was the most influential person in the field. But still, this was finally shown by Judith Gross in 80. Anyway, the proof of Gross is rather which goes later, better understood, and there are at least two proofs, additional proofs to the one originally given by Gross. Also, well, my feeling is that also very obscure proofs. Okay, So I will define this consensus. So another stain, essentially, if you can classify in the composable modules. In the composable modules are very important because every finite generated module can be written always as the exon of in the composable modules. And you want to classify in the composable modules. If you could somehow many problems would be solved or every. Okay. So another set to be if for every member, almost every decomposable module of dimension of this dimension is isomorphic to the module belonging to a finite member of. This means half dimension of finite times the variety of the composable is isomorphic to one implying in yes well these lines better defined if you take a bimodule which is on the left over the algebra and in the right over the polynomial ring one indeterminate. Then you tensor this bimodule by the simple modules over the algebra. And this algebra, this is the line, and this gives a family of, in the, of modules. And then if every decomposable lies in one of those lines, one is the algebra stain. And if it's well, if the classification of the decomposable modules implies the classification of those modules over the associative algebra in three variables, in two determinants, no commutative indeterminates. So xy is not yx. So, more formally, we can say that there exists a functor, that the algebra is wild if there exists a functor from the algebra to the modules, such that it preserves in the composable modules, and such that whenever the images are isomorphic, then the modules were isomorphic. Which means that then the representation theory of A is somehow more complicated than the representation theory over the two parameters algebra. Yes? And I will see in a moment that this is really very complicated. So, then this is why. So, from this definition, you don't see that then why is equivalent to non-tame. So it's not complementary in principle. What happens if they are complementary? So I will mention this in a moment. So just let me give you an example of a tame algebra. A tame algebra which somehow serves as a paradigm for tame algebras. So this is this algebra, which is called the Kronecker algebra. You put this and two arrows pointing in the same direction. Then, in the modern language, these were the classified by Weierstrass and Kronecker. In fact, Weierstrass tried, and he could not prove that those modules that he found were every in the composable. And Kronecker Okay, now this can be easily explicitly said in this way. If you take dimension n, then you can form this modulus from the field repeated n times to the field repeated n plus one times, where you put identity here, zero in the last column, or zero in the first column in the identity. These modules happen to be decomposable. This is very simple to see. In fact, those modules were the ones which were overseen by Weierstrass. This was the modules that he was. To see that they are in the decomposable is easy. The point is that he had classified what is now called regular modules, which are those which have the same dimension, from dimension n to dimension n, you put identity and the Jordan block with the lambda. These modules were found by Weierstrass and those by Kronecker. Well, the point is that Kronecker really proved that together they form a complete set of classes of indecomposables. Well, the wild behavior is the following. So when we look at the two variables, the modules over the two indeterminates, and we will see that the representation theory is quite complicated. What means complicated in this case? So if you take any finite algebra, there exists a fully faithful functor coming from the modules in this algebra to the modules in the two indeterminates. This implies, for example, since this is fully faithful functor, in the composables are preserved, everything is very nicely preserved. But this translates in the idea that the representation theory over the algebra in two variables is more complicated than the one over any algebra. And this is any finite algebra. And this is the so-called wild behavior. And if you have a wild algebra, since there's a function coming from this, from the model category to the model categories of the algebra, and then it behaves exactly like this. So, the proof is simple, but there's a trick on it. So, if you take a system of generators, you define a bimodule, given this structure with these matrices. And then one has to prove really that this tensoring out with this module has the property of being full and faithful. So I will not really do, but. So I go to module varieties. Now, this is essentially what we already did. But I will see that this is a little bit more precise, and I want to see in which sense more precise. So, take an algebra, an n-dimensional algebra. Then it's a base of the algebra, and the one is there with the structure constants. This means AI times AJ is just decomposed in this way, in the expressed in this way, as the combination of the E's. and in this close definition. So, the model variety is the closed pseudo-definite space of matrices formed by matrices satisfying precisely these equations. So, the group acts, a general linear group, acts and gives the orbits or the isoclasses of algebras. And we have many properties, so this is very simple, although somehow we are sticking before, so I will not look at this. So now, take two numbers, R and S. The modules of dimension R, and so is that the orbit or the modules have dimension S, form a locally closed set in the modules. It's just upper semi-continuity. Then we can count the parameters which are needed to express the module category, is modules over R, in the following way. We look at the modules of the dimension R, and so is that the orbits have dimension S. It's a constructible set, and the number of parameters can be seen to be the maximal of the dimensions of S of this space is minus S. This can be seen that to be the following. You look at the maximum number of equations which are independent in this dimension. And this can be proved to be this number of parameters. And this is important because we have the following proposition. If A is tame, if the algebra is tame, then the number of parameters is of the space of modules of dimension R is more equal to R for every possible R. And the algebra is wild if there's some R to the dimension of the of this variety of S times R is bigger or equal to S squared for every S. So, then it's obvious that these two conditions are independent. So, at least this proves already that wild is not tame, or tame is not wild. And it has another consequence, which is a nice consequence. This is the Christoph's theorem. Well, it's not that it's the only theorem that he has proved. That was the result of his doctoral thesis, the main result. A degeneration of a wild algebra is wild. And this is due precisely because one can count the number of parameters of the model varieties, So now we will make a last refinement of the model varieties, and this is really the last. Refinement. So, take an algebra as a quiver with a set of of relations. Then we can find, in this idea, we can find a finite number of generators. Take any set, any finite set of generators of the ideal and fix it somehow. Vector dimension, we define the model variety of the variety of modules having this vector dimension is a closed subset. This is key topology. This is a finite space. Okay. And the summary is determined by the group. And then here I multiply the general linear groups of dimension set I over all vertices of the quiver. Then, essentially this is the same theorem that we mentioned before in the algebra case, and this is for modules. So you take a module of a certain dimension set, this is set, this is a mistake here, and then take this tangent space to the vertex x and divide by the tangent space to the orbit of the algebra of the module, then this can be included in the extensions, in the self-extensions of x by x. This is, it goes back to Fugt. So, this, and this also is an isomorphism if you go to schemes. Since I'm just working in the varieties, then this can fail to be an isomorphism. But it has many consequences. For example, if the self-extensions are zero, if this space is zero, automatically this gives the quality of this space. And this means that the variety is smooth at the module X. Yes, and several consequences like this. And also, if the second self-extensions of X with X are zero, then the linear map is an isomorphism automatically. So the scheme, as I told you before, that this was an isomorphism at the level of the schemes, this means the scheme is the same as the variety. Or in other words. Okay. So, another application. I will define a quadratic form. This is the so-called Nitz form of the algebra. In the following way. If you're given an algebra which is triangular, this means that Q has no oriented cycles, then you choose a minimal set of generators of the ideal. Then the extensions from SI to SA is to SJ are the arrows from I to J. And one can see that then this number is invariant, is independent of the choice of R. And this can be read in the second extensions of the simple modules. Okay, then you can write this form immediately. If you evaluate a vector, a dimension vector, as the sum over the vertices of the squares of the values minus the mix products in for every arrow plus the dimensions of, for every couple of vertices. You then take the number of generators of the ideal from I to J. Then you have this. This is a quality form. At the moment, this is just a quality form. Then you don't see any, perhaps any interesting thing up to now. This is an example of how to build, for example, in this case, for this quiver with this relation. Then you can see that this is just this. This is the definition. And then the Lagrange reduction gives that this form is positive definite because you make a reduction. Okay. What is called this form? And, it goes the quality form. After Gabriel proved in 1970 the theorem that saying that classifying those algebras without the ideal was zero in Gabriel's case, he was considering the algebras as zero to quivers with out any ideal here. He found that in the algebras which have only finitely many representations in the composable representations of taxonomy were the thinking diagrams. Yep. Then the thinking diagrams and yep. Then there's an story related to that. I have 2 minutes. There's the following story. When Gabriel who presented the theorem, he was saying, okay, this algebra representation finite, and then the AN, you have the thinking diagrams, no? Then those algebras with have only this quiver, this linear quiver, then you have n plus one in the composable modules. Yep. Okay. Then he said the case Dn. In the case Dn, you have twice n divided plus 2n multiplied with n minus 1. Okay. Then you have the exceptional case, C6, C7, and E8. Then before he said the number of indecomposables for E6, from the audience, someone said the result. Someone said the correct answer. Okay. Then E7. He said, and then again, someone from the audience said the correct answer. And then Gabriel looked at the audience and asked, who is telling the result? And that was Titz. His Titz said, this is me. And then Gabriel said, did you really prove the theorem? No. Then how do you know the result? And then he said, no, I'm just telling you the number of roots of the Lie algebra associated to the case, to the thinking diagram. Yes, this was classified already by Emil Cartan many years before. But what was the relation? What was the relation between the composable models of algebras and the roots over Lie algebras, it was not clear at all. And for many years that was not clear. In fact, right now it is already clarified, but now 40 years after the talk of Gabe. Okay, so I will go on. So, if you take this teach form, that's not really the reason why it's called teach form, by the way. It's called teach form because the part of the proof is when it's certain argument, which is called the teach argument. And okay. So, if you take this quality form, an evaluating set, you take any module of this dimension, of this vector dimension, then the form is bigger or equal to the dimension of the endomorphism minus the dimension of the self-extensions. Okay, the proof is not difficult, but then, as you see, then this relates this form, which is mainly, is completely combinatorial to this information, which is homological. And in fact, in the 10 case, here I was not assuming anything about A, and then this happens. But of course, this number could be positive, negative, or whatever. If the algorithm is thin, then the quality form, the fixed form, is weakly non-negative. Weakly non-negative meaning that it is non-negative for when evaluated in vectors which are positive. Yes? So if you evaluate the form in vectors which have non-negative coefficients, then you get a non-negative number. It's like a restricted positivity of the form, or a restricted negativity of the form. And the proof is simple, but it really, where tennis is used. Tennis is used because you have this inequality coming from which I mentioned before. And then what tennis means that you have these lines defining all indecomposables. Yes? Then if you look at indecomposables, you look at the orbits of these models, these orbits have dimension, the group minus the stabilizer. And then you can see that this is equivalent to that this difference is bigger or equal to 1. Okay. The analogy enters in many ways here in play. So, we will call an algebra extremely simply connected if for every convex B in A, since this is given by a quiver, convex means convexity from the point of view of the quiver, which means that it's closed by oriented paths. Then every convex set in A, you look, we have that the first Cauchy commodity is 0, H1 of B. Again, a mistake. This is B, not A. Of course, for A also, but this is a special case. Then one can prove using for this algebras, the system is connected. The forms are weakly non-negative if and only if the algebra is not containing one of the following diagrams. If you look, these are double extensions of thinking. Yes, thinking extend by one vertex. And then again, This is the type of result which is expected in this theory, which means that if you want to one property can be reduced to having to not having, for example, certain subqueers, certain subalgebras, yes, or having, depending. Then, then in the reason, not, 2012 is recent or not, I don't know. Anyway, we prove together with Brustler, this is a German who lives in Canada now, and this is from Poland. We prove the following. If the other system is simply connected, which is the homological condition that I said before, then it is stable only if the threshold is quickly non-negative. So, then this condition is completely arithmetical, and tameness is this condition, which classification of models. Okay, this is the Zsolgosz conjecture in 1980. In fact, then Drozd gave a proof which was wrong. Well, he never published anyway for a special case of this this address that was for three addresses he resolved. This can be really used to see very, very quickly if an algebra satisfies this condition, because one can prove that therefore that those wild algebras having this property have at most 10 vertices. Then if you look at every possible subcategory with 10 vertices and you look that this is not wild, then the algebra is 10. Okay, just to finish in 2 minutes, I will say the following. You would like to have a criterion for any algebra if it is tame or wild. Yes. And also, you would like to have some device to classify all possible in the decomposable modules if the algebra is tame. Yes. This was reached for representation of finite algebras in the 80s, last century, in the following way. For example, if you look at this algebra, alpha, beta, gamma, with these relations, one can see that this representation finite. This means only finitely many decomposables. How you look at this algebra is of this type? Well, you take the so-called universal cover of the algebra, yes, or Galois covering of the algebra. Here, in this case, you have a Galois covering with the action of the group of the integers you set. Yes, you see, you unravel this loop oriented cycle in a path from 2 to 1, from 1 to 2, etc., and then from 2 to 3, yep. And then one looks at this algebra, and it's very simple to see that this is representation finite. Meaning that every finite set of vertices, one can classify the modules and you apparently many of them. For example, this is one in the composable model, and just say this model. And it's much simpler to look at the models over this algebra as the models over this algebra. For example, here you get already this matrix and so on. It's not very simple to see that this model is in the composable. Not even that, but just to classify really all the models is not so simple. Okay, then this method that we were indicating here is completely valid for representation of finite algebras in complete generality, and this goes completely together with Martinez, going back to some conjecture of Gabriel, and is the following criterion given by Bongers. The algebra is the representation finite if and only if you take the universal cover, the R is simply connected, meaning strongly simply connected, is the same in this case. R doesn't contain infinite lines without relations, of course. And third, the form is weakly positive. So if these three conditions happen, then the algebra is representation finite. In the same, more or less at the same time, the following theorem was proved. If the base of the Galois cover is tame, then the algebra above is also tame. This was given by these Polish guys. The point is, and then, if you have a Galois cover that you can always construct, if the base is tame, the algebra above is tame. But what you would like to have is the converse. So if above is tame, then the quotient by the action of the group is tame again. But this is not true. This is not true. But we needed. This example was found in 1990, so it was quite late already. So, okay, I don't give the details, but then for this algebra is false. In this case, the group acting here is just set 2. Just the group with 2 elements. And the characteristic of the field is 2, which is also conjecture that for characteristic different from 2 or 3, then such examples don't exist. But anyway. So, the question is if Galois covering space certainness. Not for every group, because we saw already that this is not true, this is false. But then, if the group is torsion-free, one expects that it is true, the preservation of tameness. Then if the group is torsion-free, this should be true, but it has not been proved. So already we have, 30 years? Almost 30 years since this was conjecture and is not proof. A partial result was proved together with Cassian, and this is completely different methods. This is axiomatizable varieties, axiomatizable categories, whatever. So, one can prove that the tame graded group algebras of dimension p are finitely axiomatizable classes. And then in this case, the conjecture holds for countable p prime residual finite groups. P prime means residual finite means that there exists a quotient, a group, such that the quotients in minute, minus are finite. So groups, so residual finite means that every element here can be sent to a quotient by a normal subgroup in such a way that then the quotient is finite. And P prime means that this is P prime means that it is not divisible by P, these quotients. Okay, it doesn't matter, it's a technical definition. But the theorem implies that, this is true in certain cases. Okay, if this could be proved in the general case, the Galois coverings will be the tool to define, to prove the preservation of plainness. More than the tool will be the way to the most general way to prove the plainness or oneness of others. Okay, this is still open, and thank you.
Well,